Hello and welcome. In this course section, we've been focusing on genome informatics and RNA sequencing in particular. So let's begin this short video with a recap of the first few steps of typical RNA sequencing procedure. We're in vivo here behind me. We go from DNA in the genome, of course, through transcription to pre-mRNA, intron splicing to mature mRNA. Then in vitro, in blue here, we have our, the lab prep stage that entails extraction, RNA fragmentation, reverse transcription to cDNA, then DNA sequencing, of course. Then from the sequencer output, we can start in on our in silico steps, where we go through quality control always, of course, then alignment or mapping of those reads from the sequencer to a reference genome sequence. And then the overall goal here of this whole procedure is, most commonly it's for RNA quantification, but also novel transcript discovery potentially, and variant identification as well. So let's for a second look at an overview of these three different goals and how we achieve them from this workflow. So again here, we have our alignment output, our mapping at the top again. And with quantification, we can begin now to simply count up the number of reads at a given region. For example, here in this slide behind me, we've got the first and the third exon. Let's just pretend for a moment that they have 15 reads each mapped to them. And then that middle exon, or the second exon there, that has less, it only has 5 reads mapped to it. So this would give us a sum for the whole gene region, right, if you add those up, of 35. Now we also often report this with normalized measures, such as RPKMs or FPKMs, depending on the type of sequencing you're doing, that attempt to normalize for transcript length and also for sequencing depth, right? And the reason we do this, of course, is because longer genes will be, they'll have more reads mapped to them than shorter genes, right? So if you're twice as long, this particular gene, it's gonna have twice as many reads mapped to it just by that virtue than a gene that's half as long. So you see that value there in the denominator of that little fraction here on the slide behind me. So this normalization, this will allow us to compare across genes of different lengths. Now we also want to be able to compare across different samples, and those samples might have a different amount of total DNA in them, for example, or different sequencing depth. So to enable this, we're going to also normalize by the number of total mapped reads, and you see that there in the denominator there as well. And this will allow us now to compare across different samples. So for transcript discovery here, we can use these results as evidence for presence of, in this example, two distinct splice variants, for example. So one variant, we'll just call it variant A here, that has 3 exons present, right? And then there's a second one that only has the first and the third exon. So we can see this from the mapping results and the read counts per exon that we determined above there. So now, the amount of DNA sequence, of course, is going to be proportional to the number of times a region is covered by a sequence read. And then if we have enough coverage, this is going to equate to more support for candidate variant sites. So finally, what we can do here, if we have enough sequencing coverage, is we can see evidence for things potentially like single nucleotide polymorphisms, or SNPs, where our mapped reads maybe consistently indicate here, for example, a T in a given position in all these reads, but the reference is different, maybe a C, for example. Okay, this is perhaps more easily demonstrated with a little animation like this one, where we have a reference genome in blue here, then our sequencing reads in black here coming in, aligning to this region. And as the reads begin to pile up, we start to see support consistently for a position like this one in the red column, where we see a consistent difference. We see a C versus a T, for example, or a T versus a C in our reads versus our reference. Now, in other places, we might see evidence for indels, for example, or small-scale structural variants. And then in other regions, we might not see consistent changes, right? There might not be enough support for these things. And this is likely to be a sequencing error here in this last example. So to recap, the work that we've done in our hands-on session from last time, we used Galaxy, or you could have used the command line if you were so motivated, to take our raw sequencing reads in FASTQ format, right? Remember, it had that quality score, that FRED quality score that we saw, that this That's one of the main differences between FASTA format. And we might have multiple replicates for each condition there, of course. And then we pass them through quality control with programs like FastQC that we used the last time, or MultiQC, then on to mapping or alignment to a reference genome. This was our time-consuming step from the last time. And that's kind of then went on to counting. This was the kind of easy stop, counting or quantification to the gene level, typically. And this is where we left our hands-on session last day. We maybe did some principal component analysis or PCA or a similar technique to see if things were looking promising. You know, if there were interesting, consistent differences, for example, between treatment and control, or obvious outliers that we'd want to or maybe need to investigate further or perhaps exclude from subsequent consideration. But what we were missing from the work we did last time out was a kind of robust differential expression analysis. Now, this is typically done back in our old friend with packages such as DE-Seq or EdgeR or Lemma. And we're going to focus in on this step now in this section. We're going to actually explore DE-Seq2, one of the most widely regarded, widely respected, and commonly used packages for this kind of analysis. And we're going to go over to R Studio and have our session open, and we're going to need to install this package from Bioconductor. Now, recall that the way we install packages from Bioconductor is different than the way we install them from CRAN, the main repository for R packages generally. For Bioconductor, we must use this BioC Manager install function. That is, there's an install function from the BioC Manager package. And you're going to need to install the BioC Manager package from CRAN first. That's the first line here if you don't already have it. And then from the BioC Manager, we're going to call this install function that comes from that package. That's what the two colons there represent, to set up a base Bioconductor setup. And then finally, with the last line here, we can tell it to go and install individual packages like the DE-Seq2 package here that we need for this section's hands-on work. So please, you know, I'll ask you to pause this video in a second and enter these commands in your R console. Actually, this is an important point here. You know, don't enter these commands in your R markdown. Put them in your console, right? Not in your R markdown. The reason this is important is if you enter them in a code chunk in your R markdown document, this thing might come back and ask you some questions, as you'll see in a second, and you'll not see them if you're doing it in an R markdown code chunk. They'll not allow you to enter in yes or no as is prompted, and it'll just sit there waiting for your input because you won't see to give it input. So please do this in your console, and if it asks you questions like this one, you know, update some packages or not all packages, then we're going to answer no. Okay, especially if it asks you something like, do you want to install a later version of this package from source? We're also going to say no, so just say no, right? There's actually a page on our class website. You'll see that under this section's material with really detailed instructions on Bioconductor setup. So if you have problems or something you're unsure about, please click on that document, read it. It discusses different steps to take when you maybe have some common problems that we've seen students in the past experience. So it's important that you do get this set up properly. Otherwise, the next hands-on section is going to be a bit dull for you, right? You won't actually have any results to look at and analyze further. What we'll actually get out of this package are results like this, where we again have a row per gene, right? A column here with, for example, log2 fold change. This is an important column here that's going to tell us about the change in expression values between our different conditions. We'll discuss where this comes from and actually calculate it ourselves in the hands-on session. But you can see here there's minus values in this column. There's some positive or plus values here. This actually tells us whether the expression went up or down and by how much in these log2 units that we'll discuss. And then there are additional columns here that report on the statistical significance of these changes. This is important, of course, because we nearly always want to focus our attention on subsets of genes that change a lot, right? But whose change is also significant between conditions. We're not so excited if it's changing all the time within a condition, right? We want to see those significant changes between conditions. Then what we'll do is we can map these subset of perturbed genes to known pathways and cellular functions through gene set enrichment, these sorts of things, to get greater insight into the biology that could be going on here. So for example, here behind me, each box is a gene product here involved in this particular signaling pathway, and you can see most of them are actually colored either red or green here. Most of them are red, indicating that they're upregulated in this RNA-seq experiment. And this starts to help us understand what's going on, why this signaling is perturbed when this drug treatment is administered, for example. Okay, so I'm going to stop here in the interest of brevity and attention span, right? And enable you to go now and try and install that DC2 package and report back. So please join me next time when we discuss more about how this actually works under the surface. And of course, the main component, the main place where we're going to really get our hands dirty with these things is on our lab session. We're actually going to work through these calculations together and sort this stuff out. So please join me then, and thank you for watching. See you next time.